Amongst Dave's many accomplishments, he's a keen musician. Indeed, he's so keen that he has written a utility to parse strings in guitar notation. We eagerly await the release of that critical code.
Wednesday.
Okay. So I think I can say without fear of contradiction that Dave is a rock star speaker. Today, Dave is going to give us an introduction to Shapeless for Beginners. The title of his talk is The Tight Astronaut's Guide to Shapeless. Take it away.
Thanks very much.
Okay, so there's a few things which are slightly different here. We've been asked to run a little bit faster to bring the schedule back, so we'll see how that goes. I'll start my timer. Also, Travis this morning did an excellent talk in which he kind of covered very quickly a lot of the things that I'm going to spend a long time talking about. So if you felt like Travis's talk was like, yeah, I understand all that stuff, then, you know, this is a much more sort of beginner-oriented session. And I also would like to say we've got free stuff, which might mean that if you are sort of torn between this and Rob's talk, you can actually just sort of skip out and see Rob's talk, because everything I'm going to talk to you about today is available as an open source ebook, which is still in draft. It's about 70 pages long. And the idea is to try and write down some of this stuff, which is sort of lots of little interconnecting rules and things. So do grab yourself a copy of this ebook. It's on my GitHub, Dave Gurnell Shapeless Guide. It may eventually move elsewhere. It's currently a PDF. It may not end up being a PDF. You know, it's all up for grabs. And as I said before, came on, but we'll repeat for the benefit of the video, the slides that I'm using today are there, and you can get all the code samples we're working with. There'll be a small amount of live coding. You can get those code samples and follow along at home. Feel free to raise your hand and possibly shout a little bit if you need to get my attention at any point. We'll take questions as we go along. Okay. So what is Shapeless? Well, I guess it's a library for doing something called generic programming. Generic programming, in my layman's understanding, I'm fairly new to Shapeless. I've been learning it for the purposes of doing this talk. So the idea is to sort of, you know, the best way to learn something is to teach, and the best person to teach somebody is somebody who just learnt what they're talking about. So it's a library for doing something called generic programming. I don't have a formal definition for that, but essentially my understanding is it does what it says on the tin. We're trying to solve problems that would normally require a lot of type-specific boilerplate once with a small generic kernel, and thus we shed loads of code and avoid repeating ourselves. And I've got the stats. It's Miles started this library 5 years ago now. And the reason I've got these stats up here is this sort of, you can't underestimate how important Shapeless is to the wider Scala community now. We've got this figure of 78 contributors, basically people who have pitched in features and got Shapeless to work with their code and all this kind of stuff over the years. And this figure of it being used in over 60 libraries is a gross underestimate that I got from the Shapeless wiki, where people can sort of say they can submit their library to be listed. So it's a library for library writers. It's a great way of putting out your library and giving people tools so that rather than write lots of specific code, they can use general rules to eliminate boilerplate. Okay, so let's talk about generic programming. And I'm going to probably undersell this a little bit, but I want a jumping on point that we can all agree on. In order to talk about generic programming, we need to talk about types. It's a good slide, that, isn't it? Nice and clean. Am I assuming that we're in the middle of the countryside in one of the nicest areas of England, and we're sitting here talking about Scala. I'm assuming everyone here is on board with static typing. All fans? Give me a yay. Okay, great. Okay, so we like types. And we like types for a few reasons, right? So there's the obvious reason that they prevent us making mistakes. You know, we can't write bits of code. The types dictate how we're allowed to combine bits of code. And I'm sure you've all written code before where the types have helped you write the code. They guide you towards the correct solution. You're sort of starting with this type, you need to get to that type, you have a few methods, and the code writes itself and is normally correct. And they do this because they are restrictive and they are specific. And they're specific for particular levels of abstraction. So we model data in our applications at a particular level of abstraction, and then the types help us work at that level of abstraction. And it all works very well until we try to change things up. So here's a simple example. I've got a couple of case classes. I'm writing some kind of restaurant app, and I want to model the staff in my restaurant and then some menu items. And it's good that we've got two case classes. It's good that we can't accidentally liquefy employees and turn them into ice cream. But there are times when we don't want this. We actually would prefer there not to be a distinction. After all, these are very similar types. I mean, this is an example, so they're pretty much identical types. The fields are the same number and the same types and all this kind of stuff. So let's suppose we want to write some kind of generic operation, like we want to serialize these things to a CSV file. So we want to write a method which turns like the fields into a list of strings, so they're all the columns, and serialize that thing out. Unless we build some additional abstraction around this, we really can't get away with doing anything but writing two methods. Right? Write basically the same code twice. And this is the kind of stuff that, you know, Travis has already mentioned some of this stuff to do with JSON encoding this morning. CSV encoding is a slightly simpler example to get to grips with, but it's all the same principles. So when we've written custom CSV encoding methods for 20 or 30 case classes in our applications, we start to think, well, do we really like types? You know, if we were doing this in Node.js, we wouldn't have a problem here. We may have different problems, but we wouldn't have that problem. And the solution is not to throw away the types, not to go dynamically types, but to change the level of abstraction. So the sort of big idea here is we're going to, on the left of this slide, we have our concrete data types, the ones we work with day to day, our concrete representations, as I'm going to refer to them. On the right of the slide, we have some notion of a generic representation, which maintains the structure of the types, but throws away all the specifics, like employee and ice cream and number of cherries. And then we solve on the right, and then we have some mapping between the left and the right. And that mapping is the thing, one of the many things that Shapeless gives us sort of for free in one line of code. And so we're going to look at how we do that. Okay. And those are the big ideas. Not only are we going to abstract over types, we're going to abstract over arities, which is notoriously difficult in Scala, and eliminate boilerplate. So to begin with, I want to talk about these generic representations. So I'm going to get a bit of ask you if you know some terms, and then we'll work out how fast we're going to go through this content. So who's heard the term algebraic data type before? Who hasn't? Don't be shy. Okay, cool. So we don't need to know what algebraic data types are. And who knows what who's seen HLists before? Who's used HLists before? Okay, so that's fewer. And anyone not used HLists before? Okay, we've got a few. Okay, so we can sort of go fairly quickly over here. So you all know that algebraic data types are ands and ors of things. This is my example. And you all know that the ands we typically call products and the ors we typically call co-products. And that in Scala, typically we represent ands, products as case classes and co-products as sealed traits. And the reason I'm telling you that is that the machinery in Shapeless exists so that if you're coding your data model like this, you get automatic conversions to a generic representation of this type for free, essentially. For free in terms of lines of code, at least. Let's say that. So our generic products, our case classes, look like HLists, and HLists are sort of like tuples, but they are like recursive sets of tuples. So an HList is either an empty HList or some head type conned onto some other HList. And so we end up with types and values that look like this. So for our ice cream, we end up with an HList that is a string conned onto an int, conned onto a boolean, conned onto an empty list. And the values that we produce reflect that type. Now, the big advantages of HLists over tuples are that tuples are set sizes, and if we write code to work with a tuple 2, it won't work with a tuple 3, or a tuple 4, or a tuple 5. Whereas, because an HList is recursive, we can traverse the type structure recursively in this inductive approach that Travis talked about this morning, and we can solve problems that way. So the types and the values sort of both have this structure. I'm going to skip showing you what an HList looks like, and we'll get right onto the writing code part of it. On the co-product side, so remember co-products are sealed traits or sealed abstract classes. They are disjunctions of types where we know the precise set of types. So the sealed part is important because it gives us exhaustivity. then we can turn them into some kind of coproduct. So the shapeless coproduct type looks a little bit like this. It's like an H list still, in that it's recursive. So a coproduct is either an empty coproduct, C nil, or it is a or a colon plus colon of some type and another coproduct. But we have these two additional things, because this or is a bit like an either, right? So for every instance of or, we can either have a left or a right. And if it, you know, if it's a left, then we actually at a value level have H. And if it's a right, we have some value that's in the tail of the coproduct. So your coproduct types, when written down, look like this. But the values look a little different. We end up with sort of nested constructors for left and right to choose a path down into the coproduct structure. This is a little bit difficult to sort of parse when you first see it written down, so that's what the type looks like. And then by producing values, we're kind of choosing paths into that type, and left and right, until we hit a leaf. And I suppose the only other thing worth mentioning about coproducts is that this C nil on the right, with an H nil, it's a, you know, it's an empty list. So there is a value for H nil, but C nil here is a bit like nothing. There's no such thing as a value of an empty coproduct. So whilst we can have the type C nil, we can't have a value of type C nil, unless something has gone very badly wrong. Okay, cool. Is everyone with me so far? Is that all good? Okay, cool, all right. So what we're going to do now is start talking about how we write code. So I'm going to go into the sort of the details of this inductive approach. And we're going to try and write some CSV encoding. CSV encoding, because we don't need field names and type names and the sort of the more advanced features, which we probably won't have time to get onto in detail here because of the shortened running time. But the idea is an encode CSV method, which will take any value of type A and turn it into a list of strings. And we're going to do that using a type class. Everyone familiar with the type class pattern? Raise hands. Okay, great. Most people. That's great. Okay. So our method will end up looking like this. With encode CSV, we take a value of type A. We take an implicit CSV encoder for an A, and that's going to solve, it's going to give us the implementation of our CSV encoding. Now, it's worth mentioning that without shapeless, we don't really get much further than we got when I introduced the function-based approach at the beginning, the method-based approach. We still have to have instances of CSV encoder for all of our data types. But the thing that we're going to get from shapeless is just one set of these rules that does every type. And the one thing I will say about type classes, because I don't think it's quite as widely known as the type class pattern in general, is that before you even look at shapeless, the kind of approach we're using is using the compiler to derive instances of implicits from rules. So hopefully this isn't too unfamiliar. We can have rules like this. If we want to write a CSV encoder for a pair A and B, we can write this implicit def, where all the parameters are also implicit. And so the compiler can treat this like an implicit val and use it as an implicit parameter. So as long as it can find a CSV encoder for A and for B, we can produce a CSV encoder for the pair. And this is, you know, this goes off in some kind of recursive heuristic search process. And it's why compile times can get long. So we're going to write five rules. We'll start off with three of them, or we'll end up writing five. We're going to write rules for H lists. So for every case class that we have in our data description, we can turn that into an H list automatically using this thing called a generic. And I'll show you that in a minute. And so in order to be able to serialize case classes, assuming we've already got the thing to be a H-list, and assuming we have already got the thing to be an H-list, we just need two rules. We need one for an empty H-list, and we need one that for a non-empty H-list that peels off the head, serializes that to CSV, and then recurses to the tail, and somehow combines the results. So that's these two rules for H-lists. We can do the same thing for coproducts, which will give us automatic derivation for sealed traits, and then we write one more rule at the end, which is given any given data type, that has an instance of generic available. So remember, we get those for free as long as we're using case classes and sealed traits. Then we can turn the thing into its H-list or coproduct representation, solve the problem there, and then we effectively map our generic representation solution onto the concrete representations. So I'm gonna do a bit of live coding here, and hopefully this will all go perfectly smoothly. Okay, so that's the first thing that went wrong. I have to click on that window. So we're in a file CSV Scala. All right, we have our type class. I've got a companion object for CSV encoder here, and I've just made myself a little helper method so that I can turn a function from an A to a list of strings into a CSV encoder, just to make stuff shorter. And I've got three instances of my CSV encoder for strings, ints, and booleans, since those are the three types in my data model. And with just those instances, without bringing any shapeless stuff in yet, or any case classes or anything, I can do CSV run, and I get out CSV. So I'm going to leave that compiler running on the right so that if anything goes wrong, we know about it. Okay, so what we're going to do is we're going to build a couple of instances for H-lists, and then we can serialize some H-lists. So we need two instances, right? We need the instances for H-nil and the instance for a non-empty H-list. So let's start with the instance for H-nil. That's really easy. There's no structure to H-nil, so we can just write an implicit val for H-nil and pure. So we're going to do that by specifying our function goes from H-nil to some CSV. There's no data here, so let's make an empty list. That's easy. And then we want to write one for a non-empty list. So here, don't worry, I'm making mistakes as I go along, and hopefully I will know what mistakes I'm making and we'll correct them as we go. So we're going to define a CSV encoder for an H-list, but we're not just going to do any H-list because we're searching for implicit by types. We need to be specific about the types. So we're specifically going to look for an H-list that is some head consed onto some tail. So we have to define these, and as soon as we have to define these, we have to turn this into an implicit def. Do that, and then get some question marks here, and then hopefully the compiler will tell me I've got something wrong. Okay, so we've got a few problems. I need to import some stuff. That's a fairly standard problem. Shapeless.hlist, cons and hnil. And now it's going to complain at me that I need to put a type bound on this thing because it's always going to be an hlist. And we should be okay. Okay, so that's the structure for our method signature. Now, in order to do any serialization, I can write my pure method, I can split my my incoming H list into a head and a tail, and basically I need to do three things. I need to serialize the head to CSV, serialize the tail to CSV, that gives me two lists, and I append them, right? So in order to do that, we're gonna have an implicit head encoder, type CSV encoder of head, and tail encoder of type CSV encoder of tail, and then we're just going to go head encoder dot encode head plus tail encoder dot encode tail. Brilliant. So hopefully that should compile, and then we should be able to encode CSV of like Dave 123 H-nil. So some H-list. So we're going to get let's actually make this a true, because you can see that we're getting typed rules, because a true is compiled to yes in the CSV. So you can see that specific instance has been located. Okay, so that's solved that piece of code. That's relatively easy to understand, as long as you're happy with this idea of the recursive implicit search, which is going to become all too familiar. So for the third rule we're going to write, I'm going to do the generic rule next, and there will be a bit of me fudging it and then explaining it afterwards. Okay. So this one is going to be, I'll call it generic enc. It's going to be for any type A, and then I'm going to just require, in order to serialize that type, I'm going to require that I have a generic, an instance of generic. Now, generic is a type class that Shapeless gives us for turning generic of A. I need to import that. A type class for turning any concrete data type into its generic representation. So as long as we're using case classes and field traits, generics will just appear magically. So we've got generic there. And then this is where the slight fudging is going to come in. I need a CSV encoder for the H-list or coproduct that generic produces, right? So ideally, what I want to be able to do is say there's a type member on a generic called repr. So ideally, I want to be able to access that type member here. And I skipped over some stuff at the beginning where I would have introduced that. But we can't do that here for a variety of reasons, not least of which this isn't in scope here until we get past the end of this parameter list. So I will explain all this in more detail in a minute. What we do instead is we say, I need some other data type. I'm going to call it L for like HList, and I need a CSV encoder for L. And then, whoops, sorry. Yeah. And then I need to say that the whatever that type member on my generic is the same L. So I'm putting in constraints here to say, okay, I need some data type A. There's this other type L. The compiler, can you work out what that is for me? Here are two implicits I need you to be able to find, and you can find any combination as long as that L is the same. Right, and there's a whole bunch of other stuff which we'll come to in a second. So then we're going to get in a value of type A, and we're going to use gen.to to turn A into the H list or coproduct, and then we're going to use the encoder to turn the H list or coproduct into a list of strings, and that's how we solve this. So this bit here is a little bit funky, and we'll have a look at that in a minute. So let's see if we can. I have a scratch file here that has. Let's get that employee and ice cream from the beginning back. We'll put them in here somewhere. We'll just check that this works. Let's have Alice. Let's have a cornetto. That's pretty good. I like cornettos. And I'll put them in here. And then I should be able to go println encode CSV for employee. Okay, great. And for ice cream. So this is working nicely. We're asking the compiler to find a CSV encoder for some data type. The only rule that it can find in our little set of implicits here is to match is this one. And then it's going to recursively go, okay, all right, so I need a generic. Shapeless will give it a generic. The generic will turn that into an H list. And then we're going to start going down through, and then we're going to start looking for an encoder for the H list, which involves recursively applying these rules and then this for the string into Boolean until we have a complete definition. Okay. Yeah.
Can I ask a question?
You certainly can.
Could you explain the step again how I get from the L to the representation?
Yes, I will show you that. I'm actually going to go right to that next. So the question was about the L to the representation thing. This is the sort of like chicken and egg thing of like I need some order and no order completely provides this. Okay, so what I'm also going to do, in the interest of time, how much time do we have? Okay. What I'm also going to do in the interest of time is I'm going to skip over doing the coproducts. So we can extend this to sealed traits by writing two more of these rules here for a C-nil and for a coproduct. And the code is basically the same. If you look in the solutions branch of the code repo I linked at the beginning, you can see the complete implementation there. It's basically just these rules and you just copy and paste a few words, and change a few words. So let's talk about that that H-list thing. Okay, so this is some fun stuff called dependent types, and I'm going to stretch my Scala knowledge to try and explain dependent types to you, but I'm not really qualified. So to try and explain dependent types, this is what the code for a generic kind of looks like. So we've got a generic as a type class. We've got a type parameter A here, and that's the concrete data type that it's going to make generic for us. But in addition to that type parameter, it also has this type member, repr, for representation, the generic representation of A. And whenever we implement an instance of generic, or whenever Shapeless gives us one, we're going to have some binding for both of these. So I have a question for you now, and if you've seen John Pretty's talk from any Scala this year, you'll know the answer already. If I write a method like this, genericify, best named method ever, it's going to take a value of type A and a generic for that A, and it's going to call this to method, and if I flip back, the to method is going to be the one to turn into the generic representation. If I call that to method, then what is the return type for that method? What is the return type for genericify? Anyone offer any guesses there? It's gen.rep, right, so it depends on gen. It depends on the type of gen. So we can write, in this instance, we can write this. So we ask for a generic of A. So what's going on here? We ask for a generic of A, and the generic appears, and it has this additional type attached to it, even though we don't explicitly write it down in the code. So it's kind of, next slide wasn't the one I thought it was going to be. So it's kind of there. That repr is there in the type, even though it's not written out here. And the compiler is able to see what that type is, and we're able to use it as the return type for this method. So the method is not only calculating a result, it's calculating a return type. When we use it, the compiler calculates what the return type is based upon the parameters that we put in. So you can kind of think of generic as being a bit like a function from some input type to some output type. And we had a slightly odd situation here where we tried to use gen.repr here, but we weren't allowed to, and we weren't allowed to because you can't refer to type members on other parameters within the same parameter list. And I assume this is something to do with the way the compiler type checks each parameter list one by one. So when you write a call to this method, let's say, at the moment, notice I've dropped all the implicit keywords off here, just to make it simple. Let's say we call this method and we just provide a gen and an enc, we provide value parameters. So the compiler will type check this parentheses list and say, can I find a binding for A for which all this stuff matches up? And after that, once it's found all the bindings for things, then gen.repr is sort of finalized and we can use it. But it doesn't happen until it's finished type checking this parameter list. So our solution was to add in another type and allow the compiler to try and find, try to unify both of these type variables. So we say, okay, look, I'm going to call the method. I'm just going to provide value parameters. And then the compiler will attempt to find bindings for A and R for which this all matches up. You could also call the method and provide the type parameters as well as the value parameters. And then rather than trying to assign those type variables, the compiler is going to check that everything is consistent. And if we go to the implicit case, when we invoke that, all the compiler knows is, I want this thing. It only knows the result type it's trying to go for. So it is then going to try and expand this method, assigning a pair of implicits that then provide consistent bindings of A and R. And I found out the other day that this tends to happen left to right. So when you're writing your implicit parameter lists, so we ask for generic of A here. So we go, well, we need a CSV encoder for employee, right? And then the compiler is going to go, okay, I know that A here is employee. I'm going to look for generic of employee. Shapeless will helpfully provide this. And then, okay, brilliant. We've got a successful candidate for that, for this parameter. And then we go here, we say, well, we need a CSV encoder for R. Well, whilst I was assigning the generic, I found out that, you know, this constraint here says that R is going to be that repr, so it's going to then find a candidate value for R, or binding for R, and then it can consistently search for this thing. So we can kind of, by putting lots of parameters in one after the other, we can kind of get the compiler, oh, find this type, and then find this type, and then find this type, and it will sort of search through some possibilities until everything is consistent. Does that make sense? Have I butchered that? Okay, hopefully. This is one of these sort of big, weird, magic-y things that the idea of this Shapeless guidebook is to try and sort of get some of these things which you either kind of have learnt through years of coaxing the compiler to do the correct thing, or they're kind of not, well, they're probably documented, but they're not accessible anywhere. So just sort of having some general rules of thumb about this kind of thing. Maybe not complete truth, but rules of thumb might help. Yeah, you've got your hand up there.
Any particular reason why you just didn't use two parameter lists?
Well, we didn't use two parameter lists. So we're in the implicit parameter list here. You can only have one implicit parameter list. That's another restriction. Otherwise, you're absolutely right. So if we weren't doing this, if I was writing genericify, the sensible way of writing genericify is to have, you specify the value in one parameter list, and then compile that parameter list, find a binding for A, and then the other thing comes along. And it's a great way of organizing code in your libraries, where you want the compiler to sort of dictate, you want one set of parameters to dictate what the type bindings are going to be. And then, so if you have you find a value A, and then you have a function from A to something, you can write that function literal without saying what the input type is if you put it in a separate parameter list, because by the time you get to compiling that parameter list, the compiler knows exactly what the parameter type is. Anyway, that's off topic. Okay, yeah, so this is all kind of valid code and this works. But writing this kind of type refinement here is cumbersome, and you very quickly get bored of it if you're using a lot of this pattern, which you use all over the place in Shapeless. So there's a sort of an idiomatic syntax, type alias syntax, that you'll see with a lot of the bits of machinery in Shapeless, where in addition to defining the type class with the output type on it, you'll get a companion object that defines an aux, a type alias called aux. And all that's doing is just giving you alternative syntax. Well, all it's doing for the purposes of this discussion is giving you alternative syntax. So rather than writing this, we can write this. Okay, still exactly the exact, all the sort of processes I've described are still exactly the same, but we just have a slightly nicer way of writing this. Okay, does that make sense? Are there any questions about that before we go on? Okay, awesome. All right, so that's one exciting thing of how we chain parameters together to calculate types. 75 minutes, 30 minutes in, 45 minutes left. Okay, yeah, so this is good. We're doing well. Okay, so I'm not going to write aux in the file. I'm sure you can all imagine that I've done that. That's all that bit of coding was. I want to talk a little bit about something that Travis mentioned briefly in his talk, which is implicit divergence, which is another fun thing that we can hit. So implicit divergence, basically the compiler is doing a sort of search for a set of implicits that are going to match the parameters we're looking for. And that search is potentially unbounded, and for certain particular patterns of types, you could just go on forever. So it's sort of heuristically determining whether it's getting closer and closer to a solution, whether it's converging on a solution. If it's not converging on a solution, it's diverging and it gives up. And we see this in a couple of cases. I can't do that demo because I haven't written the code in, but here we go. So the first situation we can get into is one where our data types are recursive. So I have a slide. Oh, I'm flustered. Yeah, all right, I've just explained all this. That's good. Yes, panic. If the problem is diverging, panic, and the compiler will give up and it'll say, I can't find an implicit, or if you're lucky, you get a diverging implicit error message. So then for data types like this, this is a tree, right? So it could be a list, but it's a tree. And notice that tree consists of a branch and a branch consists of a tree. So we have a cycle. So when we're sort of looking for, okay, I need to find the CSV encoder for a tree, so I need to find a CSV encoder for this, so I need to find the CSV encoder for this, so I need to find the CSV encoder for this, so I need to go back to tree again, oh my god, I've hit a cycle, panic, and then it won't, it'll say diverging implicits and it won't find a solution. This is a problem, and we have to solve it with another piece of shapeless machinery. But it's worse than that, because the compiler's not just checking to see if it's seeing the same type again, it's also checking to see, we have type constructors in Scala, right? And they can have type parameters, and those type parameters can have all sorts of different combinations of values. So the compiler is also checking to see if it's seeing the same type constructor again and again, and the type parameters aren't getting simpler. So here's a fun example, a really simple example, and this This is the simplest thing I could get to not compile. I've got a case class foo that has a single field bar, and bar is a case class with two fields in it. So when I'm trying to find a CSV encoder for foo, I'm going to try and find a CSV encoder for this H-list, which is colon colon with bar on the left and an empty H-list on the right. This is all good so far. So we recurse to bar, and then we try to find a CSV encoder for this H-list. This H-list is longer with more complicated type parameters, and at this point the compiler gives up, because it doesn't realize, oh, we've skipped through to a different case class here. All it's doing is saying, you know, are the types getting more complicated? It can't see the context in which it's being used. Or it can't understand the context in which it's being used. So here we will get a premature implicit divergence. The problem's not actually going to diverge, but the compiler can't see that, so it's just going to give up on us. So to work around this, we have a really crucial piece of Shapeless, which is this lazy type. In lazy, we wrap it around some of the implicits that we're trying to summon. And what it will do is it will, first of all, act a bit like a sort of a by-name parameter, where we try to, so if we're looking for a lazy, let's just write the code for it. Where is it? CSV encoder. So if I do something like this, when I'm trying to find, let's do it for this one. When I'm trying to find an H-list, if I try to find a lazy CSV encoder for the head, then the first time I look for a CSV encoder for that type, we'll go and do it, and then it will sort of reuse the same value. So you can end up having values that depend on themselves. And it also, the other advantage of this is that it sort of works around these, in some magical way that I don't fully understand, works around these divergence heuristics and sort of resets the compiler's heuristics, so it can go and do, it can go and look at the next H list, right? So the reason I'm wrapping it around head here is because I'm in an H list, I'm going to go into a concrete data type, then go back through a generic into another H list, but by that point I've kind of reset myself, so I can go and do a full scan of that H list without worrying about, is it a longer H list than the previous one? Does that make sense? Of course it does. I can't see anybody. This is a huge light here, so I'm sure it makes sense. So we can do this. So this, the typical rule of thumb that I found for working with simple cases like this is wrap the head parameter for an H-list or a coproduct in lazy, and I can do my aux thing here. That's cool.
Yay!
And wrap the instance of the type class that's going to deal with your H-list for a generic in that. And with those things, you typically anything that I've tried so far works fine. And we need to probably pull in lazy. Encode is not a member of shapeless.lazy. Oh yes, of course. Great. The compiler told me not only how to write my code, but what to talk about next. Because this is now a lazy, hank is now a lazy, I just have to dereference it. So lazy is just a thing with a single field called value. So we can dereference that, unpack it, and we're going to need that as well. And that should all compile again. And this all works, but we haven't hit any, we haven't hit the recursive cases yet, but it would also work on them. Okay. So you always want to be using lazy if you're writing rules like this. Like doing it without, you'll just hit cases where the compiler won't find an implicit. And of course, the error message you get when this huge complicated piece of machinery doesn't work is could not find implicit. So, you know, the compiler will know it's failed, but it won't know why it's failed. So it's good to dot all the I's and cross all the T's. Okay, how are we doing so far? Great, I got one great. It's a terrible question for me to ask, isn't it? Give me a yay if you're all okay.
Yay!
Yay. Great. All right then. Okay, cool. So now we can go and do some JSON stuff. So we can actually go a little bit more advanced here. So one of the things you typically want to do when we're writing these type class instances is access names of things from our code. So for example, when we're writing JSON encoding, or decoding, but let's go with encoding because it's simpler. So when I serialize an ice cream to JSON, I want to take the field names out of ice cream and use them in my JSON. And similarly, when I'm taking a shape, which is a rectangle or a circle, I want to be able to somehow, I've used this key value encoding here. There are other encodings are available. This is the simplest one to write the code for. this, I want this type name rectangle to be reflected in my JSON so that when I read the thing back in, if I read a shape back in, I get a rectangle back. I can identify what type I serialized out. And in order to do this, we need a system which allows us to represent these string values, but we need it to sort of match in with this implicit resolution, which is all type-based. So enter some fancy pieces of Scala. What we're going to use is, rather than use a generic, we're going to use this thing called label generic, which returns us what we had before at HS and co-products, but tagged up with all the relevant names. And in order to understand the names, we need to understand these things called literal and singleton types. Okay, so singleton types. I think most people have seen singleton types. If you define an object, any singleton object, it has something dot type is its singleton type. It's just a type with one value, right? So the concept of a type with one value is relatively straightforward. And I should imagine everyone has seen this before when accidentally referring to a companion object rather than a case class. I know I have. I'm sure we're all familiar with the fact that if you have an expression, so here x is an expression, you can treat that expression as a bundle of different types, right? So this is the most specific type, this is the singleton type, which only this one object is a value of, but we can also treat it as these other types. So we can do the same in Scala with literals. So a literal expression like 42 has normally, when we write val x is 42, x becomes an expression that has this type integer, which isn't any value, which isn't any. Now, in the Scala compiler today, in a Scala existing old-school Scala compiler near you, this expression also has another type. It has... it's difficult to explain. I've written the slides the wrong way. It also has another type. It has the type 42 as well. You just never see it, because when you write x equals 42, the compiler will treat that as x is an int. Or if you write the literal 42, the compiler will automatically treat it as an integer, because it's just a more useful type than the singleton type. But as of new versions of Scala, also available near you, we have this new fancy syntax where we can use 42 as a type. So this is, and we can do this with, I think, any literal, right? So we use booleans, integers, strings, whatever. So what you have here is a type, which is a subtype of the type of the subtype of int, which only has the value 42. So we can kind of let's risk disaster. We can console. This is not a shapeless thing now, although there is. So prior to, let's go back to this slide. Prior to if you were using the type level compiler, right, 2.11.8, which you totally should if you're doing this stuff, because you get more toys and more robustness. It has more protection against some stuff that can go wrong with implicit derivation. Then you can use this syntax now and you can play around with it. With older versions of Scala, the types exist, but there's no way of writing them. So Shapeless provides some macros, which I won't talk about, but they're in the book, which allow you to get an expression with that type, even though you can't just literally write the type down in the code. So there's a few bits of extra syntax to patch over this. But the singleton types are there, you just never see them. But as of, you know, so type level 2.11.8, and then these things will get folded into the mainstream Scala compiler at some point in the indefinite future that I don't know enough about to say how far off it is. It will become mainstream Scala features. But we can do sort of things like little silly examples like this. If I make x a var and make it type 42, then if I say x is x plus 1, I get a compiler error because it's type 42. 43 is not a value of that type. Just like I can't store a string in x, I can't store 43 in it either. And so these anyway, to cut a long story short, we don't need to dwell on this stuff. To cut a long story short, we can use string literal types to represent at a type level the field names from our case classes. This is where we're going. So in order, let's work towards that, right? There's another kind of fun technique. There we go. That was the macro for I said I wasn't going to talk about. we can also, so we have these singleton types. If we have these literal types, we can also use a bit of a contraption in Shapeless called a witness to turn that into a value. So we import shapeless.witness, witness has got that aux pattern on it again, but if I say I'm going to implicitly get hold of a witness for the type Dave, I can get that back as a value. Okay? We'll see. That seems rather pointless. Why don't I just go val x equals Dave? Fine, all right. That becomes more important when we do this thing called type tagging, which is kind of where we're going. The unboxed tag types, is that the official? No, okay, let's not. Mars is shaking his head, I won't say that. So here's a thing you can do in Scala. You can declare a variable, and that's this is an integer, a regular piece of data, integer, in your application. You can do something mad like this. If you declare a trait, so this is a pure trait, there are no methods on it, there's no runtime behavior for this trait, it's just a type. I can write as instance of int with that trait and change the type or create a new value of a new type. It's still an integer, but it kind of carries around during compile time this extra type information. It's this kind of the sort of thing that sends shivers down my spine, but it's kind of safe as long as there's no runtime information here because the thing is still an integer. You can't call any methods on this that aren't integer methods because there aren't any methods on tag. So we can think about this as a special integer with this tag during compile time, and when type erasure happens, it just turns into an integer. So it's runtime type, the thing that you get when you say at is instance of is just integer. And what we're going to do is we're going to combine these techniques to tag the types of the fields in our H list with the types representing the field names. So we'll get a little bit closer towards that. I'm going to just do a little demo here. I'm going to bring in another piece of syntax just to show you the general sort of type patterns. I didn't ask. I assume this is quite small, isn't it? Would anyone like me to make it bigger? No, you're fine. Great. All right. There we go. A little bit. So I'm going to just to show you sort of there's this syntax we can use. That's right. So I can do something like this. I can say field name. I can have this is another piece of syntax that allows us to take the expression on the right and tag it with the literal type of the expression on the left. So the expression on the left has to be a literal, and then we get this. The type of this is int with, and this key tag of this is. A sort of a slightly older way of writing the literal type field name. So it's still the same thing as we've already seen. It's the type, singleton type for the string field name. So key tag of field name and int. So this key tag is a way of uniquely recognizing at the type level that this is both an integer and it's got this name associated with it. So Shapeless will now, the thing that label generic will do is give us these tagged types back. I'll just show you one more thing because we're going to need to know it. There's a key tag is defined in this shapeless.label package. There's also a helper type, a type alias. So if I just retype this, if I say field type of field name, comma int, then it's just the same. That's the same thing with a type alias. So this type here and this type here are identical, but this is a nicer thing to write out. So we can take an integer tagged with this particular field name. So then, and I hope my slides have got the right ones here, we can, okay, that's what we've done there. What a label generic will do, the label version of generic will do, is it will give us an HList that looks like this. So we still, remember our HList for ice cream before was string, colon, string, cons, int, cons, boolean, cons, h-nil, right? So we've still got string, int, boolean, h-nil, but each of the fields is tagged with its field name. And we can pull that stuff out when we're doing implicit resolution. So I've got 25 minutes, so let's do this. I think the next one is... Okay, yeah. Oh yes, and coproducts, sorry, that's the missing bit. Coproducts are tagged with just the names of the case classes. So we're gonna do this with a JSON thing now. What have we got here? How much of this have I already written? Quite a lot. Okay, great. So JSON encoding. I've made up a JSON type, so this is just an ADT for JSON. I have some methods here that turn JSON into strings, just to make the printout a little nicer. I've got a couple of type classes as well, and this is just an implementation detail, but I've got a JSON encoder and a JSON object encoder, which is a specialization of JSON encoder that always returns an object. And the reason I've got that is we're going to be recursively going over these HList encoders and picking up fields in objects and kind of consing fields onto objects. So if we have a JSON object encoder that specifically deals with objects, it saves us a lot of pattern matching and stuff like that. So then I have a bunch of simple JSON encoders for various different simple data types. And we can start writing our encoders for HNIL and HList. So I've done the encoder for HNIL. I'm going to serialize it to an empty object. And then for an HList, we're going to go through this JSON object encoder, going to go the same process. So we're kind of going for this kind of target type, right? It's still an HList. It's still got a head and a tail, except with a label generic, the head is going to come back tagged with a field name as a symbol. So if I write field type here, it's going to expand into that incredibly long type we saw on the REPL on the right. It's going to expand into this long thing here. Okay, so we then need to introduce our type parameters. So I'm going to introduce all three of these things, the name and the head and the tail. The tail has to be a type of HList. We've learned that already. The head, I'm going to say, is a symbol. I'll leave that. I'll put that in when we need it, because it sounds sort of complicated while I'm putting that in, but you'll see it's actually quite straightforward if we do it when we need it. So then we start declaring this thing. So I've got this helper method to say I want to declare an object encoder. I'm going to have a head and a tail. And then I need some things here. So notice I've just pulled the head out. The head's still going to be type H. It's just tagged with this key type. So I don't need to expand this out at the value level. It's just the thing that I need. So then what I'm going to do is I'm going to say tail fields is like a tail encoder dot encode the tail. So in order for that, I'm going to need tail encoder is a JSON object encoder for the tail. Every HList is always going to become an object. I'm going to have the head value. It's going to be a head encoder dot encode the head. And for the head encoder, I don't need an object encoder. I just need any old, it could be any type of JSON. It could be a string or int. So I'm going to have a JSON encoder of, no, now come on Sublime, behave. And then I also need to know what the head name is. So what I'm going to do here is pull in a witness, that thing I saw earlier, and a witness is something to turn a singleton, a literal type, into a value. So witness.orgs is the pattern we use for k, and then I can say witness.value here, which will get back the actual string, the actual symbol that we care about, and then I have to write that dot name to turn that into a string. So every symbol's got a name field, and for that, in order for the compiler not to freak out, we have to put this so it knows it's a symbol. And then that's our, if I put in my lazy, and then I dereference this with a value, that should be our working definition, compile errors aside. So let's just see if I can get that compiling. Let's import, I'm going to be lazy. Going to need labels to get the field type. Okay. And this is going to be JSON run. Put it in tilde mode. Cool. Okay, what have we got? 592. What did I do? Yeah, I actually need to return something. JSON objects. Who knew? There's a value part to this as well. There's a runtime part to this as well. It's not all about compilation, much as Miles would have you believe otherwise. Tail fields, head name, arrow, head, value. So it's just a list of pairs of strings and JSON values. So we get that. Okay, so now it's saying value kernel. Kernel is not a member of JSON objects. That's because this is a JSON object. I'm going to get its list of fields out. And now that compiles. Okay, great. And then down here, I've just not. Okay. Compiling. We're compiling. And then we should be able to go println. How do I actually encode something? JSON.encode. JSON.encode of employee. So JSON.encode is just what we've seen before. It's a method that could not find a code. Okay, wicked. We're going to have to debug it. It's just something which it takes in the value that we want to encode and the encode JSON encoder. So, okay, I've hit a problem. I actually honestly don't know why this is going wrong. So let's see if we can work out why it's going wrong. And it's just that I can't find an encoder for this thing. In fact, I know why it's going wrong. Well, who knows why this has gone wrong? You know why it's going wrong. Okay, let's try. I'm gonna say, okay, all right, implicitly, find me a JSON encoder for employee. So we expect this to not compile, right? We shouldn't be able to find that. I actually worked it out a minute ago. Hey, thank God. Come on, file system watching. Yeah, okay, can't find it's an employee. All right, let's try, what employee is gonna be string ints boolean hnil. Okay, ah. Couldn't find for string int boolean hnil. I was expecting that to work. Ah, because it's an object encoder. Still can't find it. Okay, well, I've done a few things wrong, so let's try and fix them one by one. One of them is I haven't implemented this. So I haven't implemented the thing that turns our case class into a generic representation to solve the thing at all. And then the other thing, we'll have to just squint and work out what it is. Okay. Never mind, we'll worry about that when we come to it. So for the generic encoder, this is the one that's going to generate a CSV encoder for any type A, and it's going to do it given... Yeah, that's pretty good, yeah. See, I'm starting to think about why the other thing is wrong, so my mind's not on what I'm typing, so there's going to be some good fun consequences now. So we're going to get in a generic. The generic is going to be a label generic here of from A to some repr type. So we're going to have A and we're going to have some repr type here. And then we need encoder, which is a JSON encoder. So it's not going to be a JSON object encoder here, is it? It can be, I think. It doesn't really matter for any type L. Okay, and then that, and then this is going to be the same thing as we normally have, which is going to be pure of A goes to enc.encode of gen.2 of A. So this turns the thing into this labeled H list. And then we, okay, we're still not working. Okay, what have I done wrong? Import from the objects. There should be inside JSON encoders. Should be all right. So although we're looking for JSON object encoders, it should still work for JSON encoders. Oh, it's a super type of JSON encoder. JSON object encoder is a subtype of JSON encoder, and it's that companion types of all related types and their dogs. I'll tell you what we could do. We could just look at the solution. Cheat. Let's just try this. Let's go through the motions of, we should be able to find a JSON encoder for string. Okay, that works. Okay, okay, what? All right, so this is weird, isn't it? Right, let's not worry about it. There's something going on there, but it's not worth worrying about, I don't think.
Why do you expect it to work?
Oh, because it's not a labelled... Right. It's not a labelled H-list. That's the... Yeah, thank you. That's actually... When you, yeah, so it's all good. Yeah, so see, I was just catching... Yeah, just it's all a deliberate... God, this is what happens. Hey, it's live coding. Okay, so any questions about that general process? Like, there's type level, these literal types are a kind of an interesting feature of Scala that we don't normally see. Ultimately, what it boils down to is you have your head type in your list is tagged with this other thing, and you just use a witness to turn that into a value. for this particular use case, and then that's all it is. So it's just we're not doing anything fancy with it. But because we have the tag, we can also sort of bring that tag. It involves both the field name and the type. We can bring that tag into, like, we're actually targeting particular fields with particular names or particular types in a different way. We can start to do odd things, clever things. Yes. 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 Okay, so the question is, we can get the field names here because we have instances of the classes, but what about in a CSV file where we're trying to write an empty CSV file. Well, we're actually getting the field names from the types. So this thing here, actually, if you look at the definition of this, doesn't actually access, this never accesses a value of this type of this H list. It builds an object that will eventually access a value. But like, oh, actually I can do this. That maybe this makes it more obvious. So I'm building a JSON encoder, but I can actually access the head name before I've built the JSON encoder, before I've ever seen an instance of that H list. It's in the type of the H list. And I can rarefy it as a value from the type. That's a good question, and it's an interesting one to get around. Okay, right, I think I've got, this is going in record time. How long have we got, about 15? Or are we, no, we're over, aren't we? No, we're actually on time, aren't we? Or a bit over. I have got, okay, so, yes, that says an hour, not 100 minutes. This is the kind of stuff I have to work with in my brain. Right, so we could go through the co-product example of the JSON, but whatever. Again, you have the code for it. You can go and look at more complete JSON libraries. So Travis recommended taking a look at Spray JSON Shapeless. I really recommend that as well. Sam's done made actually quite a sophisticated library with lots of options in it, but it's all basically just sort of idiomatic uses of Shapeless. There's nothing more than you've seen here. But it's also, and it's all, you know, it's doing a lot of clever things. So that's a really good starting point to check this stuff out. I wanted to finish with an example. I'm not going to live code, but I wanted to show you some of the things that you can do. And this is something which I haven't got into the book yet. I hope to write some more stuff on this stuff, or if anyone wants to, something I didn't say about this book at the beginning is I want it to be a collaborative thing. If people have suggestions for improvement, you know, get on the Shapeless Git channel and let's chat about it, and all pull requests are welcome. So I wanted an example that kind of shows you some of the crazy stuff you can do. And this is a sort of a weird toy idea I had to do with case class migrations. So the idea would be maybe we're using a case class to represent a row in a database, and then we want to be able to remove a column or add a column or reorder some columns. And we want to derive a function to translate from an instance of the old case class to an instance of the new case class, right? So you've got these two case classes for version 1 and version 2. So we could do things like this. So here, I've got foo1 and then foo2, a new version of the case class. I'm going to add a field. I'm taking maybe b away from the middle here, and here I'm doing some reorderings. Or arbitrary combinations of these things. And this is all possible by some kind of fun chain of tools from Shapeless, none of which we've seen, but I'll walk you through it. So the idea is we try to summon a type class instance trying to summon an implicit for these two type parameters, for the old case class and the new one. And then we're going to use different pieces of Shapeless material. So the first one is we're going to convert A to an H list. This only works for case classes. I haven't got a co-product version working. Then we're going to work out what fields are in A and not in B and delete them from that H list. Then we're going to work out what fields are in B and not only in A, build an H list of those, and then append the two H lists together. And then finally, we're going to reorder the fields to be in the order we expect to then convert things back into B. And this is something that you can do without actually writing any of the code. Because there's loads of tools. So the missing part we haven't talked about with Shapeless, there are many missing parts. One of the big parts is having tools to manipulate H lists for you conveniently. So what I'm going to do here is I'm going to discard all the code I've written. Ah, it's all gone. And check out the solutions branch and just show you this code. load. Just migrations.scala. So we've got, let's just bring that over here. Bring that onto a separate screen so I've got more space. Okay. So we've got a, there's the migration type. We've got an apply method that's going to turn an A into a B. And then here we have the one rule that we need to do all of this stuff. This is it. You start to realize that your coding style has to change because all the weight of your code is in the type parameter list and the implicit argument list and not in the actual body. So we've got, this is great, look at the size of this. We've got the original type A, the type B, we've got the type of A's generic representation and B's generic representation, and then we've got a few additional H lists representing different steps. So this is going through that part of where, you know, in order to write all of this lot, we have to introduce new type variables. So every time we introduce a new sort of free variable in our computation, we have to promote it to a type parameter. So the way I wrote this was I started writing these, started looking in the Shapeless source code and finding, oh, there's this thing, I can use this. There's this thing, I can use this. And like writing them in the sequence I needed to use them. And every time I brought one in, I normally had to write an aux and go, oh, well, so, you know, I need to have an extra data type here because I need to bind the output of this thing to something. So, okay, so let's go through it. We have two labeled generics, one for A and one for B. And then we say this is an implicit we can summon to calculate the intersection of two H lists. So these are labeled generics. So the intersection of these H lists are going to be items that have the same field type and the same field name. So if you rename a field, this won't work, which is kind of what we want, right? We want to summon something with the same field names automatically and require a user to write something if they do something too complicated. So it would calculate the intersection of A repr and B repr and put the result into common fields. So common fields is my first additional type parameter. Then I find the difference of B repr and common fields and put that into added fields. So common fields is all the stuff that's in A that's also in B. So added fields is all the stuff that's in B that's not in A. Then there's this empty thing, which I've defined below, which basically will use another type class. So if you have used Scala Z or cats, I'm using monoids to find sort of zero values. So like empty strings and zero and false or whatever, like a zero value for any given type is. And then we prepend the new fields onto the common fields to get the type that we need for all of the fields we need for B, and then we use this align thing, which gives us a function to turn an H list in one order into an H list in another order. So you know, you can really nice. All of these type classes have got these instances here, types here have got good documentation. You just go, you have to look at the source code, but it's there. It's in the Scala block. They're nicely documented, and then it's just a matter of calling the apply method on all of them. And so we can sort of see down here, and then there's my empty type class, which we can skip past. And we can see here that we have things like this kitchen sink type, where we add a field with a new type, we remove a field, we reorder the fields, and then we can just say migrate this to this other type, and it all magically works. So I mean, you can take my word for it, or we can run it. I hope it works. It'd be embarrassing if it didn't, wouldn't it? But who knows? Pull request will be accepted if it doesn't. Okay, great. So it did work. So you can kind of see where I start with drop field A with three things here. I've got drop field B with two things here. Add field, we add an integer somewhere up here. And the monoid for an integer says, well, the default value is zero. So we can do all of these things. And I think this is awesome. This is really impressive. Especially given that I haven't actually really written any code here. All I've done is take existing components and strap them together. So that's kind of the power of the things, and the power of these generic representations that are recursive and we can iterate over, and the power of putting everything at the type level and allowing implicit search to do everything for us. Okay, so I think we're winding up on time. Yeah.
Have you tried having migrate to take a tuple of missing elements instead of just crashing if there are missing elements?
Oh, right. Possibly worth trying. I haven't tried anything like that, no. Only three or four. There's always one more. One more implicit. Just one. Okay. Okay, so I'm going to sum up, and there'll be time for some questions. So we've seen a few things now. We've seen quite a lot, and we went a heck of a lot faster than I originally intended to go. But so roughly speaking, we looked at these generic representations. So we looked at this generic type class that as long as you write our code as simple ADTs, sealed types, and case classes and case objects, we get for free conversions to HLIS and coperites, these generic representations which we can pull apart at compile time and at runtime and mess with them to the extent where we can do all of this kind of stuff. And then we saw a bunch of caveats around this. So do remember, you know, this lazy will help you get around situations where your types are refer to themselves, and thus we could get into an infinite loop, the compiler will stop because it thinks it's getting into an infinite loop, and get you around some surprisingly simple situations where you just can't find an implicit because an HLIS gets longer halfway down resolution. And we had a look. So this gives us, this was all the CSV stuff. This gives us the basic patterns that we're using to derive type class instances. And all of the stuff to do with singleton literal types and type tagging, I went off on a sort of a big sort of tangent to sort of introduce the concepts. But ultimately, again, if you're deriving type class instances, you don't really need to know about how to write a singleton type or which version of Scala you're using or any of this kind of stuff. You can just pull in label generic, pull in a couple of witnesses, and you're good to go. And the patterns are mostly the same. And we saw some of these things, these friends from Shapeless Ops. So there's within Shapeless, there is an ops package, and within there's a bunch of tools for dealing with HLIS and a bunch of different tools for dealing with coperops and various other things which you haven't had time to talk about. So things we haven't seen, fortunately, Travis has covered these this morning and has given pointers into all of them. So instance prioritization. So as you know, there's this classic problem with type classes where you write a bunch of type class instances, and then when you're trying to find an instance for a particular type, if there's any ambiguity, there are two different implicit vals that will provide the same type, or two different implicit defs that will provide the same type, the compiler will not be able to find things. And you can get around that with various types of things to do with implicit prioritization. Export hook should be up here, sorry. So things like having low priority implicit traits and things like this. I haven't included any of that stuff here. I'd like to get that stuff into the guide, but there are plenty of resources around the web for that kind of stuff. Not least of all Travis's talk from earlier. Performance, we haven't talked about performance, but obviously anything that's a search process is subject to combinatorial explosions, and there are things you can get around that by using some tools that we haven't covered. Again, see previous talks from the day. And then some other cool shapeless features, right? So we can summon natural numbers and things like this and deal with them at the type level. I remember trying to create arbitrary instances for Scala check where that came in very useful to try and seed random number generators and things. We haven't dealt with things like, well, there should be a missing line in here, things like turning tuples into HLIS and back again, that's all possible. Turning functions from multiple arguments into functions that take HLIS so you can abstract over functionality. There are tools for that. Polymorphic functions, where depending upon the type you put into them, you get different types out, and that allows you to map over HLIS and do all sorts of mad stuff, and so on and so on. There's all these tools. So there's a big grab bag of tools that you can use. So Travis mentioned Sam's workshop, Shapeless for Mortals, which was December last year. That's a really great thing. He covered most of the same stuff I covered here and paid some particular attention to things that I didn't talk about, so definitely check that out. John gave a great talk at AnyScala where he talked about type parameters and type members and sort of inadvertently covered dependent types along the way, which is quite nice. And then there's a bunch of different things you can look at. I put Circe at the end because earlier versions of Circe were much easier to read than currently, but spray station shapeless is very simple. Pure config. So this is a library which sits over, I can't remember who made it, but it's a library that sits over type safe config and makes it type safe. It adds in case class support. You just say, this is the type of data I want. It looks at your field names, it pulls the stuff out of your config and just does it automatically. So these are good source sources for sort of learning the patterns. And I guess in summary, I said we like types at the beginning. They help us prevent mistakes and we help us write code. And I hope this is the big thing, right? This is the big thing that we can go and tell all those dynamically typed people that this is why types are great. Because they help us not write code now. Like, we're using types to derive solutions for problems that we don't want to deal with ourselves. And this gets around a lot of the, you know, if we know these tools and we can use them well, this gets around a lot of the criticisms that static typing getting. Oh, it's too verbose, it's too complicated. I have to work around these types because they're not really helping me, they're just getting in my way. Now with these tools, we just say, hey, compiler, off you go, do this stuff for me. So, thank you very much. Has anyone got any questions? No. All right, well, feel free to chat afterwards. Grab the book, pull request of welcome. I'd like to get some more information in there, grab the source code, see what it's like, and great, thanks.